Thank you. I'm using this opportunity to talk in public for the first time, you being the public, about some writing I've been doing and a framework I've been exploring, which I don't fully understand myself. And you'll understand where I'm coming from by the end of this talk. For now, I want to just let you know that I wanted to do this live with you actually here. Let's assume that there's someone watching this as well. So my friend Marek and Nimrik is possibly watching this. If you are, hi Marek. But importantly, Marek can't say hi back to me. It's very important that we here are together and experiencing this talk collectively. And we're going to assume that this here is real, and I'm not going to pick out anything and say that's real or this is real, but that there's something very real going on right now. That's the only starting point we have. Okay, so I'm not going to get too much criticism on that unless I at least make it specific and say what I mean, right? Now, my starting point comes with some recurrent oppositions that are found frequently when discussing the difference between the humanities and the sciences. As you know, an old distinction going back to sort of German roots, like Naturwissenschaften and Geisteswissenschaften. Discussing that outside of Berlin here in the history of ideas draws out a lot of contrasts, and they're not all the same contrast, but they group, and there's a certain structure to them that I'm interested in exploring, specific and the unique, versus the repetitive and the universal. And in each case, the red one has something to do with being here now. The concrete versus the abstract, let's say pi. Perpetual movement, that is a feature of when I'm talking anyway, versus rest. The inner versus outer I'm going to hold off on, because one thing that this framework tries to avoid is any commitment to individual minds and all the problems that come with that. But the subjective-objective polarity will be very relevant. Quality versus quantity. Now, since John Locke, where we have primary and secondary qualities in things, primary qualities in hearing and the thing, and secondary qualities in hearing and the mind, things like the taste of something or its color, we're going to refuse that distinction, but that contrast would be relevant. Culture bound versus timeless principles, and self-transformation as a permanent condition versus harmony and satisfaction of rational desires. So these are an interesting set of contrasts, and I've written them up here on the board so that you can feel free to refer to them now and again as we're going through. I'm going to be introducing the PH framework, which allows the articulation of discussion around such matters, around such contrasts. And the terms P and H come from these two ancient Greeks, Parmenides and Heraclitus, most of whom I think you know of. As far as I'm concerned, they're just landmarks. Their actual works are irrelevant. We have mere fragments of them. Parmenides, we know mainly as a smart ass from Plato, where he kicks out Plato's theory of forms, and he wrote a big book on nature. Heraclitus, we have very few fragments, and he's very paradoxical, and he doesn't really like people very much. So their personalities and their works are irrelevant. The philosophical positions, the metaphysical positions associated with them form a well-known contrast. Heraclitus is all about the present. He's going to be featured the red things here. It's about the constant arising in the present moment. Where Parmenides has an eternalist view in which everything goes to the end. These two positions are well illustrated here. On this clock we have Heraclitus, where you can actually perceive change. You can see this clock is changing all the time. And this would be Parmenides' view. I've reduced the dimensions of space to make this visualizable. And this works with the notion of two-dimensional space and a temporal dimension, so that any instant would be a simple slice through this of infinitesimal duration. And this clock that we're observing changing here could be represented here, but would be represented as an unchanging sequence of clocks with the hand pointing to different places. Now, I'm certainly not going to try to suggest that one of these guys has a better view on things or is nicer or writes better poetry than the other one, but these two approaches to what we might call the real represent the contrast that has persisted since, well, 2,500 years now. In fact, it was in trying to reconcile these two views that Plato hit on his theory of forms. There's one more person lurking in the background, and that's Pythagoras, to whom this talk is particularly dedicated. Pythagoras, as you may know, was a religious person in ancient Greece. He set up a commune in the south of Italy after having gone to Egypt and Babylon and been inculcated in various religious mysteries. And he was convinced that the mathematical nature of reality, that mathematics represents timeless reality in a Parmenidean form, if you like. And he was very against eating beans, so they had some odd ideas. Right, we're just getting our landmarks here, because that contrast is so well known and has vexed us for 2,500 years that I think we can refer to that contrast. It's going to be handy because it turns out there are other things we think about that map onto that kind of distinction. So I'm going to use the P for the scale-like thing at the top, Parmenides, and H for this circular thing with fuzzy boundaries down the bottom. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to regard this as a single symbol or glyph which can be used in the context of specific discussions. And as we've applied it a few times, we begin to see commonalities among these discussions that I think are useful to see. Because these are legacy discussions, they're all very old-fashioned ones. And I'd like to just walk through five worked examples of the application of this, so that you all get confident in its use. And I want to see whether this works, I want to see how it works. And the first application is perhaps the most informative, because I'm going to use a mathematical analogy. Here I'm going to contrast the rational numbers and the real numbers, two concepts I hope we're all familiar with. The rational numbers are going to belong to the P, and the real numbers are going to belong to H. Now, rational numbers, as you know, are numbers which are formed by a ratio of two integers, two countable numbers. Real numbers are continuous, and they defy any exact definite description, by and large. Each rational number can be represented as a real number. The reverse is not true. There are irrational many. There's an infinite number of irrational numbers that cannot be represented as a ratio of two integers. And the reason I'm mapping them in this way is that this brings out some of the commonalities as we apply this framework to other discussions, which are very familiar to us from this particular pair. So there's an infinity of rational numbers, and there's an infinity of real numbers, but they're different infinities, as you sort of mathematically inclined among you are well aware. That is, we can set up a scheme to enumerate all the rational numbers, but we can do no such thing for the real numbers. Between any two rational numbers is an infinity, an uncountable infinity of real numbers. So that no matter how many rational numbers we consider, they can never take a nick out of the set of real numbers. The set of real numbers is basically untroubled, even if you pick out all the rational numbers in there. So, here in this particular example, H is infinitely larger than P and cannot be exhausted by P. It's also the case that the individual elements in P are discrete in P, and they are not discrete, they're not separable in H. So the number 3/4 exists as an isolated entity in P, and it exists merely as an infinitesimal point on the continuum in H. So enumerable, separable, countable, these are the features of the contrast that I want to bring out as we apply this in a couple of cases. And I want to repeatedly come back to us here in this room. I want to make this a very concrete discussion. If we were very ancient Greeks, and we were just inventing mathematics, coming to terms with mathematics in the first place, we could reach consensus on what an integer is. If the three apples are on the table and we're all looking at the three apples, there's a great deal of opportunity for consensus. We don't have to appeal to anything transcendental, anything outside the room, to get the idea of an integer. Forming ratios of those gives us all the rationals. There is nothing we can point to in this room that can give us a real number. If you wish to say that something has a determinate length, for example, real physical objects don't have fully determinate lengths because there's uncertainties about exactly where their boundaries are, and furthermore, there are measurement questions. We can only measure with an unspecified, with some degree of accuracy. There's always an inaccuracy in the business of measurement. So we can build arguments to construct the real numbers, and they are also ratios, like, for example, the ratio of the diameter of a circle to the circumference of a circle. But I can't point to a circle. A circle is a transcendental. It's something that's not physically present to us here. So it's unusual to do mathematics in this way, to link it to the present situation, to be so Greek about it. But I want to point out that I'm doing something else, which is I'm talking a lot about what we can point to and how we can reach consensus in a live co-present situation. That's why the co-presence of you guys in the talk is so important. I hope you feel included, Mark, and you can send me an email about this if you do. Now, thus far, all I've done is try to teach you or explain the sense in which I want to use this pH glyph. And we teach our kids in school the difference between the real numbers and the rational numbers, and we don't teach that we bore that pants off them. They're not particularly interested. But if we go back to Pythagoras, one of his number hypotheses is credited with coming up with the insight that there were numbers that could not be expressed as a countable quantity over a countable quantity. And for this insight, or perhaps for leaking the insight, the stories vary, he was drowned. That's the hypothesis being thrown overboard there. So they took their maths very seriously back there, and there's something in the structure of this question that was worth killing someone over. And I want to keep that in mind because we're going to encounter the structure of this question again and again. There's a beautiful proof attributed to Hippasus that makes use of Pythagoras' theorem that deals with the irrationality of square root of 2. It uses Pythagoras' theorem, which Pythagoras didn't invent. All that is just so much window dressing. There's something at stake in this mapping, this relation of the rationals to the reals. In general, as we articulate this a few times, in H, we're going to be dealing with something which is continuous, which is non-metric, and I want to be careful with my words here. It's more infinite than stuff in P, just as we contrast the infinities of the rationals and the reals. In P, we will have discrete things. We will have things, separable things, and we can apply measurement. We can measure things, count them, distinguish them. There's a metricity to it. And as we look at each contrast, so we've only done one so far, the question that's always getting at is how do we bridge the hiatus from H to P? And I can pose that in the present context by saying, how do we get from this room, right here where we're all sitting, to positive assertions? Because ultimately what we're doing here is epistemology. We're going to be asking what can we assert with any confidence. And I'm doing it in a slightly unusual way by repeatedly coming back to our embodied presence in the room. This is why the pH framework is a little odd. So let's see, does the structure that we just outlined in mapping from the rationals to the reals, can we make sense of that in the second example? If you look at the philosophy of time, you immediately run into a burning question, which is how do we relate the notion of a present to the notion of clock time, all laid out. This is essentially built into the Heraclitus Parmenidean contrast. The Scottish philosopher MacTaggart distinguished two series, the A series, in which there's a present with a past that's gone and irredeemable, and a future that is undetermined, or unknown at least, and the notion of a present. And he contrasted that with the B series, in which things simply have dates and times. There is no notion in clock time, there's no way to represent the present. Now, this is just I'm sure you've all encountered this, maybe you've wondered about this, the philosophy of time is just stuck with this contrast. So we're just stuck with a pH contrast here, very clearly, and I haven't gone far from my sources here. As I said, Parmenides and Heraclitus would be the normal reference points here. On the, when we lay it out like that, the P, the clock time, is metric. In fact, that's what a clock is. A clock is the way that we meter such time. And the present moment is non-metric. Now, I'm avoiding, scrupulously avoiding, psychology here, because I want to talk a bit about what psychology is. I'm avoiding individual minds. It is, psychologists have a notion called a specious present, which would suggest that you live in a fuzzy bubble of about 2.5 seconds of the past, and I live in a similar fuzzy bubble. But right here in this room, I can find no such, I'm aware of our presence, our co-presence to each other, but I'm not aware of any fuzzy bubbles. All the big questions in time relate to bridging this hiatus again. How do we get from H to P? How do we unify these two notions of time? Something which is a burning metaphysical interest and is not going to be solved here. I'm not trying to solve any problems at all here. I'm just trying to look at the structure of problems. This will be very familiar when we talk about time. Everyone's met this. Given that we've abandoned the notion of individual minds, however, it might be less expected that the same distinction applies to space. The two Kantian a priori is time and space. Now, this, I've used these pictures to illustrate two notions of space. On the right, we have a drawing with very strict linear perspective, a technique that came into being in the 15th century, around the same time as the Galilean notion of space was replacing the Neoplatonic notion of space. In the Neoplatonic vision, space was layered. It worked differently in the heavens than it did down on Earth. In the Galilean notion, space was the same everywhere. Space was just a big box in which stuff happened. It was a big container. And the rules of drawing the box are the rules of linear perspective, and time is another dimension to that container. That is not the view supported by modern physics, but it's very close to the way that we normally think of space and time as being like containers in which something happens. But I want to point out to you that that's a transcendental abstraction. This illustrates the subjective view of space, if you like. Space is not evenly distributed and everywhere the same for someone whose eyeball is about to be cut with a razor. The space immediately in front of the eyeball is of dire and burning importance. We here in this room are not experiencing this familiar notion of space because space is divided among us, it's shared among us, and we've got personal spaces. I'm not going to go everywhere here, you're not going to go everywhere here. We're aware of people going by. Space is not evenly distributed. Nobody's ever experienced this kind of meaningless space as a container. We experience space in the present. Coming back to the temporal notion, this is a well-worn distinction, the present moment of becoming and the eternal succession of clock time. Where this is going, one way this is going is to allow us to understand what a historical story is. If we tell the story of the Second World War, or a story of evolution, or you recount what happened to you today, all of those are historical stories, and they blend these notions, that's why I've got this red and blue alternation here, in ways that we're usually not aware of. But we need, because we're dealing here ultimately with questions that have to do with what we can assert, how we can reach consensus on things. When it comes to historical narratives, we're going to have to be very careful because we can see that there's a possibility to get our wires crossed. And one goal of the present exercise, I think this is one thing that this is working towards, is to lay a claim that we can't be said to share time. That is, we here in this room can be said to share time, but time sharing is a matter of construction, and such construction demands that we work towards sharing a reality. So this is very much a relativist, non-realist view, if you like. It doesn't assume that it's simple. It's a simple matter to say, meanwhile in Shanghai. The meanwhile requires some means of bridging the hiatus from H to P. It does sound odd. To me it sounds very simple, but I just want to give you a flavor of where this is going. Now I want to give a third example. And this one is also very familiar, also mathematical, And it's kind of a surprise to me that this should be working so well for such diverse problems. I want to discuss the nature of axiomatic systems. So we discussed numbers before, and the Greeks were familiar with numbers, and they did a lot of arithmetic. But they had a second branch of mathematics, which was geometry, and they didn't do calculations in that. They drew on the ground continuously. And they proved theorems. And Euclid's axiomatic approach to this was the gold standard for mathematical truth for 2,000 years. It's no longer the gold standard. Euclid's approach was to start with some sentences, axioms, statements, which were obviously true. And he had five of them. And I've drawn those here as links from H to P. They're in P because they're statements they represent. And because we claim that they are true, in Euclid's view, they relate back to the indubitable ground on which we stand, literally. They relate back to here. So I want to imagine Euclid here drawing stuff with this thing on the ground. And the way that axiomatic mathematical systems work is you start with some set of statements, which are assigned a truth value, and then you have more or less mechanical means for deriving subsequent statements. Each such subsequent statement will cast another line from P back to H. These are additional truths, which we have stumbled upon by transforming the original five statements. You've all met this, and you're probably all aware that Euclidean geometry was upended in the 19th century with the discovery of non-Euclidean geometries. One of Euclid's axioms, the fifth one, about parallel lines never meeting, turned out to be optional. One could imagine spaces in which this axiom, or rather the inverse of this axiom, was true rather than it being simply undecidable. So I've replaced, I've generated a different axiomatic system by using a different axiom. And this is kind of odd because it's an interesting thing about this particular problem is that space locally always appears Euclidean. It turns out the space we live in is probably not Euclidean, but you have to look at very large distances to see this. To convey this truism that you can't tell the difference, I just remind you that you're standing on the surface of a sphere, but locally it looks flat. The sphere is big enough that you can't spot the curvature. And this is in general true of distinction between systems which instantiate one or other of these axiomatic systems. So with that, the anchoring of geometric statements in the indubitable lived world is seriously questioned. That is the notion of truth as it relates to mathematics. We know mathematics is unreasonably effective, but it used to be clearer that some mathematical statements were simply true. Feynman. Richard Feynman, the physicist, helps us here. He's going to feature three times in this talk. He helps us here in distinguishing between Greek mathematics and Babylonian mathematics, which is a nonce distinction he's taken. It's kind of nice because Pythagoras did go to Babylon as well as a slave. In the Greek system, we start with axioms assumed to be true, and we derive subsequent statements, and truth value is propagated through this forward change. If your original statements are true, everything you derive from them using rules of logic and inference is also true. The Babylonian approach, which I think more captures the spirit of actual mathematics, is you just start somewhere with some bunch of statements and you derive other statements. There's no assumptions of truth. That's all left still to be discussed. You just ask, where can we go from here? So if I've got a new transform or something and I've got some data and I want to find out, well, if I employ this transform, the data look somewhat differently. That's cool. There was nothing in that act of transforming the data that made reference to truth or the relation of things from one intellectualized transcendental abstract domain to the grounded present. Is everyone getting this so far? These are three cases where we have a remarkable structural similarity in the problems. Now, I don't know if any of you, I know, well, you two at least, will be familiar with Gödel's incompleteness theorems. I don't know if the rest of you are. You may have met them.
I'd say familiar is overstating it a bit anyway.
Right. Well, I actually ended up going back to college and starting college because I read Gödel Erschebach by Dirk Hofstadter, which presents a wonderful, if somewhat long and long-winded version of the nature of Gödel's proof. I find it remarkable that I can express Gödel's incompleteness theorems directly in this, using this one symbol. Gödel's famous incompleteness theorems assert that there's no mapping from P to H that exhausts H. That's all it says. So you can visualize it like this. I've drawn these lines that go from statements in P to states of affairs in H, or anchors in H. I've called them anchors. This is like casting a mesh. Any formal system will cast a mesh from P to H, but no such system is powerful enough to span H, to capture all of H. So if you think of casting a mesh has holes. I find that, from my understanding of Gödel's incompleteness theorem, that is a pretty succinct statement of what the Gödel's theorem is about. And that makes me think this might be somewhat useful, this way of looking at things. I want to bring it into a fourth example. Are you doing okay? Is everyone okay? I know that there's a lot in this. Fourth, I want to go into the philosophy of language, because hell, we're not doing that today, right? I want to go back to 20th century philosophy of language, which, like Euclidean geometry, is looking a bit old-fashioned now. Back in about 1905, Bertrand Russell kicked off most of analytic philosophy with an essay called On Denoting, in which he spoke about the use of referring expressions. Referring expressions were things that could occur in logical propositions, which he understood to be sentences, and which referred to things in the world. That is, they cast from P back into H. They picked out things in H. So when I say chair, I'm picking out this chair. That's a referring expression. Now, he started off, so here you can see, this is the kind of stupid sentence that the logicians like. John kicked the ball. By here, red and blue are just arbitrary. What I've done is, by using the word John, I've employed a referring expression, which presumably refers back to what we call the real world. John kicked the ball. Now, there were many logical problems with this, not least because the world doesn't divide up in any obvious way. When I pick out a chair, that's a utilitarian sort of division of the world. An ant walking in here will not pick out that chair. When I pick out the chair, I isolate the chair from many things, including the floor from on which it's standing, its past, its maker, its relation to all other chairs. By using the chair, I have, as it were, chosen to discretize that which is continuous and to make finite that which is infinite. Now, Russell was well aware of this, and his view of how logical statements refer to the world, propositions refer to the world, changed over the years. And he backed himself into a corner where at the end, by about 1939, he only had two referring expressions, which were this and that. And I was very amused to find a really interesting formal system. Henry, we were talking about this recently from Gordon Spencer Brown, developed in the 60s in England, which went one better and reduced that totally outlandishly elaborate scheme to one expression, which was this. And if that seems a little absurd, think of it for a minute. If we say this and that, we've partitioned into two entities. But the way that I'm understanding referring expressions, when I say chair, I pick out something, but I don't thereby articulate a complement. I don't thereby articulate not chair. I've left not chair entirely undefined. Whereas Russell seemed to be working, in fact, Russell's positivist view, which fed into scientific positivism, logical positivism, was that basically the universe is innumerable. The universe can be counted. It consists of a finite number of things. So this is an interesting way to use this. We can understand the naming of something as throwing an anchor from here to be, and thereby bringing into being a domain of discourse. So on this view, ontology is the act of naming. This, to me, is exciting. I don't like to think of ontologies as being like they're dictionaries. You get in the shelf and you go, well, I wonder what entities there are in the universe, and you look them up. If we are present here in this room and I talk about, what's that smell? Or I say, who's the clique? Who's the cabal? In each case, I brought your attention to something that wasn't part of the situation. I've now defined a discourse, and we've introduced a discourse, a domain of discourse. Naming is, I don't share most of Russell's view on language, but I do think we agree that naming is very fundamental to language. And let me give you, if someone were here playing chess or Go, and I said, let's talk of this, and here I am using ostentation, pointing things out in the present again, there's a lot of ambiguity left, which you are going to have to pick up the slack on, because that's what it is to coordinate. I could mean the game, in which case the domain of discourse has things like chess moves in it. Or it could mean the objects, in which case we might be engaging in a discussion about that beautifully handicrafted board and pieces. Or it might be meaning the players. I could be talking about plans and abilities and skills and ranking and dementia and what have you. Simply saying this doesn't actually serve to determine that. That is, what the domain of discourse is something that we co-create. This is the Abby, this is the link to Bakhtin, which I'm not going to pursue right now. So I'm interested in this notion of a domain, the domain of discourse. And we speak differently and lean on different assumptions in different discursive contexts. Because what I'm asking here are questions about epistemology, I'm interested in what the practice of science is, how science sees itself, and how we deal with the warrant that scientific claims seem to generate. But science is a very multifaceted sort of affair. The idea that there's a single scientific enterprise is nonsense, not laughable, risible, although it's often treated like that, unfortunately, in public discourse. I'll say at the end of the talk what I mean by science. I will list a couple of major developments within this heterogeneous activity that we call science. And I will leave psychology firmly out of this, because on my view, psychology is not a science, which I'll make clear. And now, what we've got here is a means of shedding light on questions, which doesn't answer them, but does bring different questions into alignment with each other, so that we can spot some kind of commonalities. I tried applying this to this old chestnut, P equals NP. Many of you know the P equals NP issue. Arthur and Henry, the rest of you don't know P equals NP. P equals NP is one of the great outstanding problems in mathematics, and in computer science. It's the great outstanding question in computer science, and one of the great, probably in the top 10 anyway, in mathematics. And we're not going to try and answer it here. There is a class of problems P, and there's a class of problems NP. At issue is whether they're the same set. If they are the same set, then there's nothing that belongs to P that doesn't also belong to NP. If they're not the same set, then there's something which belongs to NP which doesn't belong to P. Now, I don't want to answer this. I want to shed light on this question instead. And I want to ask, why do we find this question so bloody important? Like I say, if you were in computer science, there's no getting around this one. So let me say briefly what these P and NP refer to. They both refer to computations done in a representational domain. So we're all in P here. Supposing I give you an unfilled Sudoku game. We can represent that formally. And I can ask you to complete this. And you'll do your best to fill in the blanks. And eventually, after a lot of pencil work, you'll come up with something that's a solution. So you'll go from something which is an initial state, which is not a solution, to something that's a solution. If we're going to play the P equals NP game, we have to be able to do this kind of thing. We don't have to provide a solution, but we have to be able to recognize when we have a solution. We need some criterion for saying what a solution is, for distinguishing some transformed representations as distinguished. In P equals NP, a funny question arises. We ask whether we can find this solution quickly. Now, I've used the word quickly, and that does not normally feature here. We ask formally the answer is, can we find it in polynomial time? But I'm going to say that what we mean is quickly, and I think this is where things get interesting. The nature of these problems is such, so if we're playing this game, then given a start state and a solution, we can verify that there's a path from the start to the solution, an algorithmic path, we can verify that quickly. That means in polynomial time or faster, but we'll just stick with quickly for now. What it doesn't, all problems that we're dealing with here can be verified in that way, but following a path from an initial state to a known solution is not the same thing as finding a solution from the starting state. That's at issue. If you can find the solution just from the starting state, then it belongs in P, and if you can't, then it belongs in NP. And we have lots of problems that we believe. Well, I don't know, what do people believe? Is there consensus? Is there a suspicion in the community that P will be equal to NP? Seems like there are some problems that are just going to stay hard.
Well, the thing, to be clear on that, is every problem belongs in NP.
Every problem can be expressed in this way.
Yeah.
So the overpopulation is not a problem that can be expressed in this way, but every problem that can be expressed in this way belongs in NP. That's right.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of further refinement on this with NP complete and so on, but we need to go there. What I want to do, because we're dealing with transformations of representations, all in P, I want to suggest that the bringing in this notion of quickly is very odd to find in formal mathematical transformations. Normally we're dealing with the structure of a timeless Parmenidean set of statements, representations. Bringing in the notion of quickly, and I emphasize quickly rather than in polynomial time, introduces concerns about time and resources, energetic concerns. It pulls the whole questioning down into the world of lived beings in a way that's not immediately obvious if you express it as polynomial time, but if I say quickly, that makes it a very odd mathematical question at all. So now this game that we play when we ask questions here means it requires us to articulate a problem, that is to cast a domain, P. And the question we're asking when we ask is P equal to NP seems to me to be very similar to Hippasus's question. It seems to me we've introduced energetic constraints, time, finitude, into what was otherwise a purely formal mathematical problem. So like I say, I'm not going to solve it, but I think by casting it along with these other problems, we are made aware of the dimension of the question of P equals NP, which is interesting and suggests it might be a religious question. It might not be a formal computable question. That's where I'm going with this. So you see, I think something's at stake here when we employ this framework, and if we do so carefully. And what we're doing is more akin to what Wittgenstein taught philosophy will be doing, that is hermeneutics. That is, what we're doing is we're trying to understand what we're trying to do as we try to solve questions, in full recognition that we do so from a specific embodied contingent location. This is also very similar to, for those of you who know it, Maturana's notion of objectivity in parentheses. Objectivity in parentheses is a phrase that arises in a particular kind of epistemologically informed theoretical biology, where we deny that anything can be said with absolute certainty, simply without further qualification, but we set up domains of discourse, and within a domain of discourse we behave ourselves well, and we can distinguish between the objective and the subjective and so on. But we have to do it in parentheses, in this self-conscious fashion, as it were. So what I'm suggesting is, as we employ this, those entities that we summon through the naming magic in P represent reality. I'm going to call H very, very real. It's nice that the real numbers map onto H. And things in P can be said to exist. So this chair exists. Now, you know how many discussions run badly because people can't agree what exists and what doesn't exist, right? I'm separating reality from existence here in this discussion. Just as a rhetorical strategy, as a means of organizing our difficult discussions. So the claim to reality of things that merely exist is importantly different from the claims of reality of H, which is here where we are right now. Any statement you could make of our presence, any description you could give, any video recording, any Facebook Live video recording you could give of what's going on in this room now would not exhaust what's going on. It would miss all the qualitative stuff, for starters, would miss the shaping of this by the individual perspectives who are here gathered. So I can make that even simpler. H is real, and things exist in P. This means that as soon as we start making determinate claims, we're thrown into P. We have a domain of discourse. But we always have to justify or bear in mind that the hiatus that is bridged from H to P is something we can become aware of, and it seems to always imply something of, shall we say, a leap of faith? I don't know whether that's the right word to link, but clearly we're getting into theological ground here. This is why I'm very, very surprised to find myself in here. H, by virtue of everything I've said, H is not representable. That is, the rationals can never exhaust the reals, right? It's necessarily unrepresentable, infinite, and real. We partake in that which is real, right here, right now. That is real. Whether you think of that as God, or Brahman, or the void, I'm not a theist, but apophatic theology is not restricted to theist discourse. As soon as we make a positive assertion, as soon as we say, the chair, this is cataphatic. That means it asserts something definite. By the mere use of a word, or an image, or a model, we are thrown into the domain of discourse in P. And felicitous debate, and that's what I'm really after, felicitous debate tries to ensure a common background understanding of how we bridge from H to P. This hiatus, I think, has to be a matter of consensus in any discourse. Here's Feynman the second time, when he's asked, you see, Feynman insisted that physicists could never answer why questions. They could describe things, but they could never answer why questions.
You see, when you ask why something happens, how does a person answer why something happens? For example, Aunt Minnie is in the hospital. Why? Because she slipped on the ice and broke her hip. That satisfies it, people. It satisfies, but it wouldn't satisfy someone who came from another planet, knew nothing about things. First you understand why. When you break your hip, do you go to the hospital? How do you get to the hospital when the hip was broken? Well, because her husband, seeing that she had the hip was broken, called the hospital up and sent somebody to get her. All that is understood by people. And when you explain a why, you have to be in some framework that you allow something to be true. Otherwise, you're perpetually asking why.
That's what I mean when I say we are always in some domain of discourse. We have to be in some framework in which we simply allow some things to be. If we are to reach consensus from a present, then I think what Feynman is saying is we will never have something like explanation in any satisfying fashion, unless we simply allow some things to exist, including, for example, this chair. So, what I'm getting at is that every time we assert something, we're, as it were, being political. We're making a bid to control the world, to insist that the world is one way rather than another. A positive assertion brings in its wake a claim of authority. Authority for action, constraint, or control. And my question is, what can we assert? Now, I'm standing outside of science here. I'm trying to understand what business science is. And I've recently gotten into a lot of Indian philosophy, and there are discussions that have been going on there, epistemological discussions that have been going on for 2,000 years, where they have done far better than science, to my mind, in this. Now, science sees itself as a truth-producing machine very often. Ignorant science sees itself as a truth-producing machine. So there's facts, and we're stacking up, and we're just getting more and more facts, and they're all in the literature. I'm very interested in how do we go from here to some kind of justified actionable consent. So how do we go from here to action? How can we achieve the kind of statements that are consensual? Bear in mind that science is all messed up with questions about global warming, for example, and we've got a socio-economic system that's collapsing. We really need to understand what the bounds are with which we can assess things. And here I think the Hindus have done us, and Buddhists, have done wonderful work. If you go back over 2,000 years to the Samkhya school, you'll find perception, reason, and testimony as being the three grounds for epistemological warrants. Now, the first two of those, perception and reason, those are the rational and empirical poles that ground scientific epistemology. We use reason, and we have knowledge which is grounded in the senses, and the Western epistemological discussion through Hume, Descartes, Kant, has all revolved around these two poles. What I want to point out is what a sloppy job we've done. The Buddhists, incidentally, are just as sloppy. They also only acknowledge those two. At least there are a lot of Buddhists in those. The Samkhyas included testimony. Now, by that they meant we don't have to buy into their discussions. I'm not interested in converting you to Hindus. I'm interested in the form of the discussion that goes on there. Science has its commitments to testimony. We have peer review. We have journal articles. We have, once something enters the literature, it's very hard to get it retracted. And so if we were discussing and trying to reach consensus in this room, it's not enough to produce a journal article. You have to assess that journal article and see, is that a predatory journal? Is that something that should have been retracted? Just because it's in the literature doesn't make it scripture. Right? So I think actually the scientific approach to the literature is scriptural, and that really bothers me. But there's more. So in the discussion among the various Orthodox schools here, they pointed out that the warrants that positive assertive claims make come from other areas as well as direct perception, I see it for myself, this is the empirical one, reason, I figured it out on the basis of known facts, testimony, I heard it from a really good source or read it in a really good journal. Analogy is in that for over 1,000 years, the Nyaya admit this one. Analogy, we do that in science all the time. We build models. A model is nothing more than an analogy. A model says, here in my model, we move this and this and this, and there's stuff in the world, and they map one to the other. And if it's a good model, then that's grand. So we're mapping from P to H all the time. So we use this, but we don't discuss very often. Well, I mean, in some circumstances, we have to. In the case of climate change, we desperately need to understand how good is our analogy. What does it capture? What does it not capture? The Vedantins admit 6 of these. I'm going to deal with the 7th one, which some of the Mimamsas and I think Vaisheshikas maybe use. And that's tradition. One could appeal in discussion if we wanted to do something to tradition. One could say, let's go have a game of marbles because we've done this every year on the steps of the chapel or something like that. And it doesn't carry a great deal of authority and everyone might buy in. So my point is not that these can condemn you to acting in one way or the other, but that these are relevant concerns as we discuss knowledge claims. Circumstantial evidence and postulation. With this, we get the entire business of statistical inference hypothesis testing and all the scientific practices which psychology students think constitute the whole of science. That is, we go out and we get some data that we assume to be representative of something and we draw inferences about unseen populations with certain degrees of probability. And I don't really care whether we're in a frequentist or a Bayesian frame of mind here. This has long been recognized as a separate one. We need to understand how strong is this. This is handled desperately in the psychological literature. I mean, it's just appalling the amount of insensitivity to the commitments here. Structural absence. This is one of the most heavily debated pramanas in Indian philosophy. We have examples here. Once you identify a structure or regularity in the world, sometimes the absence of something can be a formative as well. This is how Neptune was discovered, how we find new elements, the International Phonetic Alphabet, the whole structuralist enterprise, which assumes that reality falls into these patterns where you can then refer to the structural pattern without referencing its anchoring in any real world. It's very mid-20th century kind of science, but we use it as well. That's my point. We use it as well. Now, I think the epistemological debate, the sensitivity to these, is something dreadfully missing from science. We haven't curated them carefully, but we're in this bizarre world where our science and our politics and our religions and everything get messed up. Evidence and argument are not the exclusive property of science. The PH framework here can allow us, perhaps, to recognize in any given situation what are our commitments, how are we, what are the assumptions we're making as we map from our shared lived reality to some kind of representational scheme, be that positive assertions, computational models, or what have you. So the move is to go from the idea of a grand unified theory as the final product of science and turn science back into what it does best, which is a method, a tool, a practice, and a form of dialogue. If it's scientific, it agrees to benefit human lives. I think this is really important. I think it's a different kind of epistemological footing for science. Now, I'm not the only one who's been complaining about this in science. The stupid notion that man is not part of nature, that man stands separate from nature, this bifurcation which Whitehead objected to so strongly, has given us a real problem. And I mean, some of this in our study of ourselves is oozing and riddled with old theological assumptions that we're half divine or that we stand outside of the cause of nature and so on. And it's very difficult to get away from this split between mankind and nature, not least because we work in a framework normally in our discussions where we assume there are individual minds belonging to private subjects which observe a single mind-independent reality, which is non-negotiable. That is a real problem. The framework here is different. No such split is real. And different stories in P will allow you to articulate this in different ways. John, this leads back to our dual aspect monism discussion. This is dual aspect monism for those who care about such things. So here's what psychology is on this view. Any of our stories, any narrative accounts that demand consensus, will contain agency and attribution of responsibility. I don't see how you run a society unless you can do that. For a given distribution of agency, it's necessary to add something to your representative domain here. Now, it's not enough for me to pick out Henry, but I have to posit some unseeable elements to Henry, which I've called here a P world. Right? You can call it a mind, if you like. It's an additional, unobservable entity which is required to underscore an account of agency. As we do that, we are psychologizing, and there's nothing wrong about that, but there's also nothing real about it. That's why I say psychology has a separate existence. It's not in the business of uncovering truths in the way that science is. And by psychology, I mean mechanical accounts of memory, attention, and perception, primarily. Psychology is all kinds of things. It's counseling, it's care, it's all kinds of things, but I don't know what psychoanalysis deals with. I mean the kind of science, the psychology that sees itself as scientific. To my mind, there's nothing wrong with doing this. We need to do it, but we need to know what we're doing when we do it. So I'm suggesting that, the view, the kind of science that's articulated here is getting away from this split, strong split between subject and object, in which the world is simply existent. I did say this is not a realist view. And to catch up with some science, there's been a lot of work in science in the 20th century, in cybernetics, in complex system science, and biology, that can deal with subjectivity in a different way by considering systems which are inextricable from their environments. So here are two such. This is a whirlpool, which is a dynamically individuated entity. It's not a static collection of matter. It's a dynamically individuated entity, so something which only exists in H. Can't really be described in P. You can't take that whirlpool out of the water, right? The whirlpool is an organization of the water, just as you can't take life out of matter. Life is an organization of matter. And here's the classic inactive cell swimming up the chemotactic gradient, an example I know some of you are more than familiar with. And there's an interesting difference between these two. To the cell, we attribute agency. We say it acts in its own right, it's towards its own purposes, intrinsic purposes. This seems to be the fundamental characteristic of the living. What I'm suggesting is that attribution of agency can be done self-consciously, knowing that it's not simply an existent, it's something that requires buy-in. In the case of the cell, we won't have a problem. We've got 5 minutes left. Mm-hmm. So, we're dealing here with a contrast, a continuously recurring contrast between a continuous H space, which is ineffable, non-representable, but somehow real and indubitable. That's why I asked, I know it seems a bit silly to ask you, do you really think this is real at the moment? I don't want anyone sitting here thinking they're in the Matrix in the simulation. Right? Well, I'm definitely right here, right now. Something bloody real. And P, which is these domains of discourse that we throw up all the time, representations, discrete and countable metric, so we can't do without them. This is how we conquer time and space, for God's sake. Where we can say that things are existence, but as we do so, we are committed to some means of bridging the hiatus from H to P. In a theological framework, I was tickled pink to find Kierkegaard supports me. God does not exist, he is eternal. This is, means that the ground of being, Brahman, or this, it doesn't work for a transcendent Christian God, but that which is indubitably real, ineffable, and here, doesn't exist on this scheme, right? It's real, but it doesn't exist. And this is why one cannot name, this is why God's name cannot be spoken. There's a lot of theology here. Now, I'm going to wrap it up here. I could go further. I think I've done enough. I've stumbled into on a discussion in contemporary Buddhism in Japan, which fits this beautifully and has all kinds of consequences for cognitive science, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to come back to where we were. This was an attempt to point out some recurrent tensions as we artificially cleave the sciences and the humanities. Stephen Jay Gould said science, when it's done properly, is one of the humanities. I'm a disciple of Stephen Jay Gould here. I believe science should work in human interests. But in each case, here the specific and unique, the concrete, movement, subjectivity, qualities, culture bound, because if we start here from this room, we're starting with these particular people. There's a lot of the world not represented here. We want to be cautious with our assertions here. We don't want to be making claims about humanity, for example. And the transcendent realm of the repetitive and universal, the abstract. And so these contrasts keep coming down. And the kind of science as I see it is this development from the mechanical world that gave us these containers of time and space, through thermodynamics, which gave us some means of understanding structure and order and the arrow of time, with nonlinear thermodynamics, far from equilibrium thermodynamics, especially important. The odd historical accounts we get of evolution. Evolutionary theory is undergoing a rapid change at the moment, vastly different from what it used to be. The extended synthesis is really, really exciting and plays in here. The view of matter, which went from simply being something inert to being something which is peculiarly involved with the observer, which we get from quantum physics. And for my mind, the next thing to come here is an understanding of how we coordinate and what human beings are doing as we employ language, as we cast these domains from H to P. So instead of drawing it like that, I could have drawn it like that. This is the Japanese Zen Enso, drawn in one stroke. This is metric, the slide rule. And I'm going to finish on time with two conceits that come out of this, which I've been rattling around in my brain now for a couple of years, but I haven't been able to talk about them. So all I've done is worked up to them. The black ones are the ones that rattle in my brain. Of experience we cannot speak, and measurement will be negotiated. But I've put teeth on those now. Of experience, I mean, we cannot, in positivist terms, represent H. That's what I mean when I say of experience we cannot speak. Measurement will be negotiated, which means a goal of science and epistemology is to find common ground for reaching actionable consensus. This is not the business of generating timeless truths. This is the business of coordinating from a human center. Jesus Christ, that was the talk. I did promise you a wild ride. I hope I made good on that promise. Yeah. I don't know what it's about. I don't know where I'm going with this. I can't let it go. So.
Because you're onto something.
I don't know. Am I just deluded?
I think so. And what I'm listening to and hearing in all of that is so many points of concordance with phenomenology, Buddhist philosophy, and enactivism.
So you all have very different expertises, and that's why I wanted you guys here now.
Not finished. And I'm just sort of wondering about whether, you know, your notion of bridging between the P and the H, maybe that whole idea of bridging might be holding you up. And I'm thinking it because it's still sort of separating into two. Like you've still got a dichotomy there. Whereas you might find perhaps, the Gestalt idea of perception, which Merleau-Ponty uses a lot, so that you've got your P within the H. Is it the H?
Henry, thanks, Vince. Mm-hmm. I know you've got some.
I'm
not trying to bridge.
Okay, well, you said bridging quite a few times.
When we have a discussion, we bridge. We necessarily have assumptions about some things that exist.
Yeah. And
this is Feynman's point, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And with the Gestalt thing is that whenever you sort of identify the P, the entity or something, the H will still be there as an indeterminate, presence that it will still have a positive influence. Yeah. I'm not
sufficiently well travelled in Gestalt psychology.
Yeah.
I think some of it would come back to that language discussion as well, the distinction between the this and that of Russell,
mm.
which suggests that things are just lined up and we're just selecting from
yeah.
them. And Spencer Brown's alternative that by foregrounding this, we bring into being, as it were, an unarticulated background,
yeah.
which
yeah.
I think is closer to the
okay.
Gestalt psychologist's
yeah, yeah.
idea. So I'd be very interested in seeing how this applies, because Gestalt psychology is funny, it hasn't yet fitted in. It doesn't know where it fits yet.
Yeah.
And this might be a way
yeah.
to unify some discussions there.
You know, I just like Merleau-Ponty's use of
yeah.
it for his perception.
Yeah. Oh, there's a lot of this informed by Merleau-Ponty, of course. Yeah.
Yeah, some great stuff.
Mm. Wonderfully integrative and heroic attempt to walk in that direction whatsoever.
Yeah.
Pure masochism in its highest form. but so necessary, you know, because again, I mean, being integrative, science is about anything is hopefully what it's about. When we talk about unified theories, we talk about anything, we hopefully want to know things in respect to other things to some extent, although that doesn't always happen. I wonder, in the sense of making things verbs and you know, seeing these things as live processes, if you know, everything you've already highlighted is very helpful. They're just really useful thinking tools about anything that we do.
Mm-hmm.
The kind of questions and the unsolved problems, I wonder, are they inevitably part of the process in some sense, that there's some sense that it is always an active process. You know,
oh,
there's
yeah,
satisfaction
yeah, yeah.
that can be reached. And
I'm not seeking resolution.
Fair enough, exactly. That there's literally, that's it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You sort of got it. Sure, there'll be more refinement. That will infinitely be the case. But
yeah.
again, you know, Alan Watts keeps coming to mind when I'm looking at a lot of the points there.
He's a bit of a sort of reference.
Yeah, I'm thinking in an experiential sense again about the kind of point he'd make, that from the perspective of an experiential sense of something, that actually full knowledge would lack certain knowledges, because you would have to not know certain things
mm.
to be able to experience. Alan Watts would say something along the lines of God, used in a whatever way you want, couldn't know everything because he would know everything. We would have to split ourselves individually into respective consciousness, limit and kind of disconnect from certain knowledges to have certain experiences and perceptions, essentially.
So,
and that
so
seems to be this active process or kind of churning that's happening that I don't see.
You pick up on something that I didn't get into, but I was going to mention. These considerations have come out of my empirical work, my empirical scientific work on John's speech. As you do that, you are drawn repeatedly to these practices that ground people in different ways, that give them unstated and unstatable convictions. I don't like to use the term belief, which is a Christian term applied to
mm-hmm.
non-Christians. I use the term the ground of being, or the ground from which we speak. But I'm increasingly convinced that we cannot unify the realities of everybody in the world. And we shouldn't even be attempting to unify the realities of everybody in the world. Rather, we should be learning to live with pluralism. This is why I'm drawn to the Hindu schools, which have had their dogmatic differences over the last 2,000 years and have engaged, nonetheless, in very productive debates that have sharpened the arguments within each school without thereby collapsing the schools. So there's the six orthodox schools of Buddhism of Hinduism and Buddhism and Jainism have this 2,000-something year-long structure, and I'm fascinated by it, and I think science could really, really learn from it. Yeah. Arthur, what do you
think? There's quite a tour de force, I must say. there's a few sort of little things that I'd like to draw attention to. So, and there's no particular theme to this, but when you had that clip of Richard Feynman and his thing about
the why question,
you have to just let things be, it's as though I was reminded of what you were talking about, Euclid and the axioms, and it's as though he's saying you have to just accept as axioms whatever it's necessary to accept as axioms in order to give an explanation that is going to be.
That's a very close analogy, and I want the analogy to be close. It's not exact, because Feynman's not talking about mathematics, he's talking about how do you explain to a Martian that Minnie went to the hospital after she broke her hip.
Yeah.
Which is not derivable in the Euclid system. but it's very, very close.
Okay, but if you imagine some sort of propositional calculus or something in which you could state axioms and rules and just accept them as true when the need arose. It's as though that's what he's saying is necessary in order to answer a why question.
Any human observer who's observing Aunt Minnie and trying to explain why Aunt Minnie is now in the hospital will necessarily rely on what they perceive as uncontestable shared assumptions. These are not dogmatic explicit statements, they're uncontestable shared assumptions. Because I know how partners work, I know that her husband's going to be looking out for her. I also know that distress is something that we treat in this society in some sense. Those are uncontestable shared assumptions. If we didn't have those assumptions, then we'd have to stand back and find what do we share before we can work together.
There are other sets of assumptions that could make it work as well.
Sure.
Yeah. So it's not that they're not even incontestable.
The shared uncontested ground, I don't think is enumerable. I don't think it consists of these six statements. I don't think it can. I think it is necessarily, just as H is necessarily not exhausted by any description, representation, picture. So the uncontested background, this is similar to the Gestalt psychology question, the uncontested background assumption is not articulable. When you articulate it, you're committing us to a domain of discourse, and you know, maybe the right domain. The domain itself will be shifting all the time. This is Abby's area where we're dealing with. I don't like to think of P. We're not always playing chess, so the rules of the domain and the assumptions of the domain are shifting in any conversation, as they are here with us. I mean, we just introduced an alien, for God's sake. Change things.
Also, you had that thing that very close to the end about the whirlpool. You said the whirlpool was something real in H, and then you said it doesn't exist, it's not in P. But previously you'd said merely the act of naming something put it into P.
Yeah.
So how do you square that with saying that it's
Yeah.
Although you've named it a whirlpool, it's not in P.
I can't use language without naming. I will necessarily cast some. We're always conversing in some domain. As regards assumptions as to what the world consists of, there are object-based ontologies, which assumes the world is made of things, and there are process or relational ontologies, which assumes that the world is made of relations. And which one is prior, seems to be a matter of taste or religion or something like this. What has happened is that in the last 60 years or so in science, we have developed a very powerful vocabulary for recognizing well-formed entities which are not things, which are instead suites of related processes. This seems to be the nature of the living. It's what distinguishes a corpse from a living being. It is not the matter, because it's the same matter, it's the organization, it's the patterns of relations and the means by which it sustains itself in its immediate environment. So I think this is useful for getting us away from the view that things in P, remember I said they exist. For most people, that's the end of the discussion. Once we find out what exists, we're finished, we can all go home. What I'm saying is they exist for the purposes of this discussion, and we need to always talk about it, and we've got a better language for talking about that. The whirlpool can be said to exist, but its existence is not of that free-floating kind. As a dynamically individuated entity, it's not extricable from its milieu. And that seems to be relevant when we're discussing the living and society.
My feeling is that when you give something a name, if you're saying naming it puts it into P, it's actually a different kind of thing that's in P. It's a sort of an individuated thing that isn't an individual in nature. It's the name itself is in P, but the thing that it names isn't. And I think it's probably a rather rare case that you can take a transcendental number like, or an irrational number like pi, and give it a name, and then say that puts that number, which is part of the continuous realm of H, into the discrete realm of P.
That's a very good observation. Yeah, that what are the things that normally so as you said, if we take the real and rational analogy, It's a very strong structural analogy, so it's useful in illuminating all these questions. Why is it that pi can be horsed in with a reference to circles? I mean, we need circles in order to construct pi. But the number, a little bit to the right, remains nameless and will remain nameless unless we find the transcendental that brings up to the four.
And then there's an Leibniz number as well, for instance.
So I think this kind of thinking is useful I dedicated the whole thing to Pythagoras. For Pythagoras, mathematics revealed the world. The world was mathematical, and perception, if you like, was a form of revelation. It was a form of, the world is intelligible when one comes at it with a mathematical mindset, I suppose. So I think this can go both ways. I think this could be of use in mathematics as well. The application to P equals MP. I mean, it's not going to do anything new for Euclid's and non-Euclidean geometries. It's not going to do anything new for the reals and the rationals, but it might inform us about how we name such things. That's an interesting cut on it. And the only purpose it can serve in the P equals NP is to try to point out why this is such an important question for us. Why we sort of keep getting drawn back to this. Because, if you're a computational event, this question seems to be sort of a vortex that you keep getting drawn back into. I gave 5 worked examples. In the Gateless Gateless blog I'm writing, I've got lots more, and it's any question that has to do with authenticity, identity, essence, reference, representation, and chains of transmission. That's a lot of questions. They all sort of seem to be addressable here, so what I'm doing at the moment is just writing around these to get straight, and so this has been extremely important to me to be able to talk about it, to see that I don't fall over when I'm talking about it. But what I'm getting ideas now about where this might go as well, so that I had not thought of that question.
I must say I find it difficult to distinguish what you mean by real and existing. So you gave this example of God and Brahma being real and yet not existing. But to me, they're not even real. So in my view of the world. But you seem to think that things can be real and yet not exist.
Yes.
Is it possible for them to exist and yet not be real?
Batman exists but is not real. We can talk about it. He generates money. There's loads of domains of discourse in which Batman is a real entity. He makes money out of films.
But you said he's not real.
He's not really saying
a real entity. So
he's a named entity. He can feature in domains of discourse. To that extent, he exists.
But isn't real.
Isn't real.
Okay.
Isn't going to walk into this room.
Okay. And so we can name. So we can give something a name like unicorn. And that doesn't mean to say that there is now such a thing as a unicorn. It's merely an item in a universe of discourse.
That's very interesting. Yes, we here, who are all from an academic sort of environment, who are used to conducting many kinds of rational discussion, we can invent unicorns. And then we sit back and go, okay, what's your unicorn got that the last one did? Naming things is very, very powerful, though, because on this view, what we're doing when we're naming things is we're projecting forward towards some domain of discourse, as I've called it, which will have its own rules. Now, we're here tend towards the computational and the simple and the transformative. I'm very interested in existential anthropology, that is, in trying to find out what the world views of people who are very unlike me are. And there are very many systems in which some names bring people from that culture, community, I don't want to be used too prescriptive here, they bring obligatory associations. This is how magic works, basically. In some systems, you can conjure up entities. They can be conjured up, and I'm not denying the reality of those for whom the links from H to P work in that fashion. I could go further, but naming seems to me, I am trying to understand epistemology in a way that will allow people who have magical beliefs, because I believe we all have magical beliefs, to be quite honest with you, our trusting in psychology seems to me to be little more than an inheritance from scholastic Christianity.
Are the magical beliefs then the things that are real but don't exist? So that's the right way around. So like the God characters, in the sense that they're...
Well, God was not a character. No, I confuse people with this. The words God and Brahman here do not refer to anything other than to an acknowledgement that for very many people, that which is immediately present is indubitable. That, and that's why I kept coming us back to this situation here. There is something indubitably real right here, right now. It's that conviction, which I'm convinced underlies most theologies. When you start trying to articulate that, then you build up these Baroque magic men with big beards or ineffables. You build puzzles. But there's nothing puzzling about being here right now.
But then the idea of, say, something that people believe in, like, I suppose you could pick Batman, but it might be confusing because of the previous discussion. But something like, say...
Superman.
Individual responsibility or...
Similar.
Or angels or, you know, something that...
Categorical imperative. Right?
Like you talked about before, that would frame a set of behaviours that to a different person who doesn't have those assumptions or that background belief, the behaviours don't make sense. So is that a distinction of something that's...
That happens every time we have a disagreement. So had we... I asked Mark to come, unfortunately. He's a cognitive psychologist. I was interested to know what someone who's apparently fully committed to the truth-revealing nature of cognitive psychology would have to say to all this, because we will find ourselves operating from fundamentally different principles. So my use of the word God and Brahman was difficult there for Arthur, and I fully respect that, and I'm not sure that we can reach a point where we can get over that, but it doesn't matter.
And so my use of the word myself and mind, to me, they're real. My ability to name them gives them the status of being things that exist. They're in my reality, but you seem to have this view of the world where there is no such thing as an individuated mind, and I find that difficult to come to terms with.
That's fine. I don't think I said anything that was intended to convince you of
my
position.
No, I'm just saying that my reality and your reality are not necessarily the same. This is where the...
And I'm assuming that's the truth for any diet.
But the fact that you can use the word, well, yourself, when talking to me, to refer to something that I believe real, but you merely believe exists, makes it possible for us to have some sort of communication about that.
Communication can be seen as finally reaching that pristine set of propositions that capture the truth, but communication can also be seen as a means of really coordinating our behaviour. And what I'm trying to do is nudge the entire enterprise of science away from establishment of truth, which gets preserved as scripture, because I think that's a retrograde step, to processes and means for reaching actionable consensus. If society were to collapse today and we were to rebuild it, we would find ourselves in an anarchic situation where political, scientific, and religious questions would all necessarily be on the table. We sort of keep them artificially apart at the moment, but we know that we get problems as a result of that. But I'd like this to suggest an approach to consensual knowledge production. That is, the arriving at the means for consensual action. And I think that's definable in this system. Well, within this framework. It's a loose framework at the present. As you can see, the wheels are falling off.
It might always be illusory anyway. Rather like communication is somewhat illusory.
It seems there's a lot of overlap with... I can't tell if, you know, the things are familiar to me from you or from other readings.
That's what it is to be a PhD student and a supervisor, yeah.
Yeah. I wonder about your pluralism, particularly, and how that plays out, what shape that takes.
Well, if you read, I know you're looking at Latour a little bit at the moment.
Well, through other people, really.
Through other people, but if you get to the inquiry into modes of existence, he's always talking about bridging the hiatus, and he never says what the hell he means. Some of my language is probably developed from Latour's perplexing mindset and ontological fecundity. This is ontologically very plural,
So, right, okay, if we talk about, so you're talking about Mark, this cognitive psychologist, and if you want to kind of respect a pluralistic view and you say, nevertheless, we want to bring all these things into the PH framework so that we can all make progress together. It's hard in some sense to see that as maintaining a kind of pluralism, you know, because in some sense you're saying, well, if we just reframe all of our thinking together and you think a little bit more like me, you know, there's still some kind of prescription as to here's the best way to think. In other words, you should be a pluralist too. And you don't. That's just not problematic.
That's not problematic. No, no. I'm not trying to reach any particular set of beliefs. In fact, I'm throwing in the belief notion at the window. I'm not using it. A lot of people may appeal to beliefs. I'm not appealing to beliefs. I'm trying to figure out what it is that we're doing as we reach towards the kind of statements that we can say, "Let's do this." Which is political, you know. Let's lock Mark up for the rest of his life because of his heretical opinions. Or let's promote him to a super professor.
Yeah. Super opinions.
Yeah. So do you find a lot of congruence with those frameworks?
Yeah, you know the stuff I'm reading. Well, you know some of the stuff I'm reading at the moment, but I'm following the Segal stuff and Whitehead stuff, and Latour has been very important here,
right.
Process philosophy generally.
Yeah.
But I've also been following the positivist, logical, Bertrand Russell, Dr. Wittgenstein, and at the same time doing this deep dive into Indian philosophy, which is all, that's why it's kind of so weird.
Because it seems to me that they give us a the people you mentioned, Whitehead, James, they give us a good, a really graspable pluralism, you know, something that makes sense when you lay it out, and seems to accommodate the type of things you're interested in as well.
They're points of reference, of great reference to me. I mean, having articulated the PH framework, it would be good to revisit some of these classic, go back to some of William James's classic writings and see it. How does that look in that context? I mean, this is now the lens through which I read William James, or I read Whitehead. What I find is that this is a great lens for reading very many people, from Plato to Whitehead, and all the footnotes in between.
Yeah, for me, it's like a lens through which to evolve in some sense.
Yeah.
You know, once I wrap this around my ongoing efforts, it opens up a means of negotiation.
I would say I'm curious. If I presented it well today, you may find yourself using that framework as just to project something you're reading or some argument you're thinking of on.
Yeah.
If that happens and you find it useful, I'd like it if you let me know, because I want to know what this is good for. Obviously, this is not a one-person exercise. Yeah, it's so far it is. But it's not. Wasn't an original word in there. Everything I get comes from someone else. But I'd like to find out where it's going, what use it is for other people. It's intractable disputes that might be illuminated. It's difficult arguments that might be simplified.
Mm-hmm.
And it's epistemological goals that might be made more modest, shifting course from the search for truth to the search for consensus. That motivate that, I suppose.
Do you think it requires a revision of scientific categories through the PH frame? You know, so all of a sudden we're not just, it's not pluralistic insofar as, okay, there's this way of approaching it, there's this way of approaching it, and these two things will run, you know, parallel forever.
Well, I've had to undo a great deal of useful assumptions in my own thinking as I've gone on. So I've had to work hard at trying to see back past the Greeks, find out what the hell was going on with Pythagoras as he went off to Babylon and Alexandria. What the relationship between the Indian schools is and the Greek schools. And when you do that, then you can't assume that there's any distinction between philosophy, science, and theology, and politics. They all have to be undone. And that's what I'm trying to do, is trying to just provide, or work towards, a means for overcoming some of those very rigid distinctions that we've inherited.
Yeah.
So return to the pre-Socratics.
And before,
yeah.
And what's up with the Vedas? It's a chanted scripture, and we've got written scriptures all over here. It's very interesting. It's very interesting. There's lots to look at here.
It's great. I really enjoyed the session today, Fred. I thought, you know, I was a big thinker. You were a very big thinker. You got
a fool.
Sorry, just one question,
yeah.
Fred. So when you talk about reaching consensus. So if, for example, consensus between, so if I want to follow a certain direction for my own research, for example, and say I want to define, say, identity or digital identity, would that consensus be between myself and my supervisor, or the people in this room, the scientific community?
Well, if you go to define something, what you're doing is you're structuring a domain of discourse, right? And presumably you're going to use that domain of discourse together with other people. So you define digital identity in some way, and you apply that, and you discuss with other people, some of whom might be me, some of whom, most of them won't be me. And if you've done your job well, then you have good conversations, then those are useful conversations, and you don't get yourself tripped up over the failure to identify different background assumptions. This doesn't provide you with a recipe for doing what you're doing. It might be cautionary in as you employ one definition or another definition, be aware that you're shaping the ground in which other people will be playing as well, and they won't necessarily know the structure of that you're assuming.
Shaping or discussing with others, and
well, it's rare that we can say that P is a finalized domain. If we're discussing moves in chess, it is. There's a finite set of rules in chess, and as long if we were having a conversation where my turn in the conversation is pawn to e4, and your run is a knight move, then we've agreed everything about that domain. In conversation, that's not the case, and there's a continuity between the formal arguments of mathematics, the strong arguments of science, and the tenuous arguments, but influential nonetheless, of politics and mere communal living. There's no hard divisions between those. So that you will find that no matter how rigorously you define digital identity, you're going to engage in conversations in which the domain over which your description ranges is subtly shifting all the time. It's shifting based on the contributions of the other person, based on where you arrive at together. You know this idea that conversation is not a fixed entity and doesn't range over a fixed domain, but that the common ground is constantly shifting and negotiating as we discuss. So, I mean, that's about all I can say as far as its relevance then. I think we'll call it a day, will we? Can I just say thank you very much, you guys? I mean, this is possibly the most favorable audience, the most supportive audience you could design. I designed it. Not taking any chances here.
I thank you too.
Thanks so much for
thank you.
Yeah, no.